Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. This morning we will take evidence at stage one of the Coronavirus Discretionary Compensation for Self-Isolation Scotland Bill, and I'd like to welcome to the meeting John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, James Wilson, Head of Contact Tracing and Supporting Isolation Policy, Michael Teague, Team Leader of the COVID-19 Legislation and Daily Contact Testing, and Marie Penman, Solicitor of the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. Thank you, everybody, for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to briefly set out the purpose and the background to the Coronavirus Discretionary Compensation for Self-Isolation Scotland Bill. At the start of the pandemic, we took steps to suspend the duty on health boards set out in the Public Health Scotland Act 2008 to pay compensation to people they asked to self-isolate. As it became clear that the coronavirus pandemic would require a very large number of people to self-isolate, this was vital to ensure that health boards were not subject to significant financial and administrative resource impacts. The suspension of this duty is contained in the UK Coronavirus Act 2020. Many provisions in the UK Act are due to expire in the spring 2022, and this bill takes steps to ensure that the suspension of the duty to pay compensation remains in place. Given the recent increase in cases of Omicron, this is vital to ensure that health boards are not subject to additional financial and administrative impacts as they continue to provide public health and health services. Members will be aware of the existing support for isolation that exists. This includes the self-isolation support grant, a one-off payment to those earning the real living wage or less who are notified to self-isolate. This is a vital support to those on lower incomes, helping them to financially weather a period away from work. There are also other forms of practical and social support available, including the local self-isolation assistance service, which provides help to those who need it, with things like essential medicine and food delivery at local level, and the Coronavirus National Assistance Helpline, which is available to help with any queries relating to COVID-19. Scottish Government analysts have estimated the cost of reverting to the 2008 Act's power, whilst we are experiencing high levels of cases, to be about £380 million, some 20 times the budget for the self-isolation support grant. For this reason, and to prevent financial and administrative burdens on health boards as they seek to exit this pandemic, the Scottish Government believes this bill is a necessary step to ensure that we can continue to provide support and protect those health boards as they provide essential care. This estimate was undertaken prior to the emergence of Omicron and will be revised in line with updated modelling. It is likely this estimate will increase significantly. At this vital time, it is important that we protect our health boards and ensure this vital support continues. And I look forward to answering questions to the committee.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. If I can turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. In light of Omicron, I know that the guidance for those who should self-isolate was last updated on the 11th of December. Could you please explain for the record exactly what has changed?
What has changed, Convener, is that for individuals in households where there is an individual in that household has tested positive for coronavirus, we ask all, we require all in the house, in the household, to self-isolate for that period. So that's the material change previously. If an individual tested positive in a house, then others in the house could receive a PCR test, and if they tested negative, they could leave self-isolation. But under the new rules, we've changed that to the position I've just stated.
Great, thank you. And also, unlike in England and Wales, there's never been a legal obligation to self-isolate in Scotland. Instead, these rules are all explained in guidance. Can you explain why this is the case?
We take the view that we are essentially inviting individuals to cooperate and collaborate with us in this agenda. We recognise the importance of self-isolation, but we also recognise the importance of public consent in the work that we take forward. And the behavioural analysis that we have undertaken, and we listen very carefully to behavioural scientists on many aspects of the pandemic, indicates to us that it is best in this respect to work closely and invite the collaboration of individuals in what is a common endeavour to control the spread of the virus.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Can I move to members now, and can I please bring in Murdo Fraser?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just have one fairly technical issue to raise about the bill, which was raised with us by the Law Society of Scotland. And I should say for completeness that my register of interest discloses that I am a member of the Law Society. The point they make is in relation to Section 4 of the bill, which sets out the process by which ministers can make regulations, and states that if ministers consider that regulations require to be made urgently and come into effect immediately, then it must be accompanied by a statement of reasons. And the Law Society believe that that statement of reasons should also explain why it is necessary to make these regulations urgently before they were approved by Parliament. And I wonder if I could ask the Cabinet Secretary if he could outline the scenarios in which he thinks the emergency legislation might be used, and what safeguards will be put in place to ensure effective parliamentary scrutiny?
I think in terms of the circumstances in which we may have to move at pace, I think are demonstrated rather by the experience we've had about Omicron. And I've rehearsed some of this with the committee before, I think, and I certainly have in various media interviews. 3 weeks past Tuesday, the Cabinet concluded that the coronavirus situation was in what I would describe as a reasonably steady state. Cases were high, but they were stable, and the vaccination programme was performing extremely well. So we considered the pandemic to be in a reasonably stable position. Within 48 hours, we were being briefed about the emergence of Omicron in South Africa. And in the space of those, it's actually 3 weeks today since we got the first briefing about Omicron, we can see just the scale of change and the pace of change that has happened. So in a sense, I would use that sequence of events to illustrate why we have to be in a position to move swiftly with legislative change if it is required. Having said all of that, I think it is important that we handle any issues about the making of legislation with great care and to maximise the availability for scrutiny. And the Law Society makes a reasonable proposition about the statement of reasons, and I've asked my officials to explore that point. And I will certainly, I suspect it may well be an issue the committee will reflect on in stage one report, and obviously I will look with care at what the committee says in that report and respond accordingly. But I do think there is a reasonable point made there by the Law Society, and I'm asking for that to be considered now, and will obviously, if the committee reflects on that and its committee, will respond accordingly. But I think the argument I would make is that events are moving very quickly in relation to the pandemic, and we may have to act swiftly. Finally, Convener, I would indicate to the committee that I remain available to appear before the committee literally at any moment. The committee would want to see me to take evidence from me on the development of the pandemic. The committee has scheduled meetings on a Thursday morning. If the committee wished to meet at any other moment in the week, with reasonable practical notice, I will appear before the committee for scrutiny. So I wouldn't in any way want to suggest, I appreciate the need for scrutiny. I am a parliamentarian, but equally I think the committee appreciates the need for the government to move quickly. And if that requires an urgent session of the committee to be established, I will be only too happy to appear before the committee.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. That offer is very much appreciated. Can I please move on to Alex Rowley?
Convener. So when we've taken evidence so far on this bill, I think most people agree that this is the right way to go in our NHS. We'd be overwhelmed otherwise. But could I ask Deputy First Minister around the self-support grant? Because clearly, if you want people to comply with self-isolation, they're not going to be able to do so if they cannot afford to feed their families or pay the rent or the mortgage. So in terms of the self-isolation support grant, are you confident that there is enough resources there? Has there been any analysis done in terms of who's accessing and who's not accessing? Has there been any analysis done in terms of the promotion of the self-isolation grant and how that information is getting out there? And is the eligibility criteria suitable given the numbers of people that are being asked to isolate?
In terms of the eligibility criteria, we've obviously set that as being eligible to individuals who are earning the real living wage or less. And we judge that to be an appropriate level given the fragility of incomes that of incomes of individuals at that level. The question of adequacy of the grant is an important issue, and we feel confident that given the other measures that are in place in terms of financial support for individuals in such circumstances, combined with the self-isolation support grant, that provides an adequate and appropriate level of financial support for that 10-day period. But of course, it is an issue we have to continue to consider and to be mindful of. In relation to the promotion of the self-isolation grant, it's obviously whenever an individual tests positive, they are pointed in the direction of the self-isolation support grant to make sure that they are aware of its provision. For some people, they will not be eligible because of the level of remuneration they have, but it's certainly pointed to anybody that tests positive. And there are, as I indicated, a range of other measures in place that can provide assistance to families facing these difficulties. But I do accept the point in principle that Mr. Rowley puts to me, that the payment has to be adequate to enable individuals to be prepared to comply with the requirements of self-isolation.
Thank you. Can I please bring in John Mason?
Thanks very much, Convener. And yeah, maybe first of all, to follow on from the point that Alec Rowley was making, that, I mean, we did have some evidence that I think especially women were not aware of or going to get hold of the grant. And I wonder, you know, given that it may be that more people are going to have to self-isolate over the next 2 or 3 months, if there would be an effort by the government to you know, re-emphasise, reiterate the availability of the grant?
We need to make sure that individuals are aware of the provision. I just was checking there for a moment on, you know, when I did my lateral flow test this morning before I left the house. I've got my email there from the NHS confirming it was negative, thankfully. But it also gives a link to the self-isolation support. So there is a very direct connection there, which is really promoting the information on a regular basis. I accept there are other avenues for us to communicate these messages, and I think from what members will hear from the advice that's given by the First Minister in parliamentary briefings and other media briefings, there is a very significant amount of emphasis and attention on the provision of the self-isolation grant. But I certainly will, I'll take away the point that Mr. Mason makes to me, that there may be a case for us to look in greater depth at how we can further promote the availability of the grant, and I will endeavour to do that.
Thanks, that's helpful, because I think the Deputy First Minister is exemplary in the number of tests he does, but, you know, sadly not everybody in society is doing that quite as much, and therefore they're not getting that same kind of feedback information. but I appreciate the answer. I mean, more generally, is it fair to say this bill is about saving money? Because most bills spend money, but the key thing here is that it would really would severely damage the NHS if they had to pay full compensation for people's loss of wages and everything. And that's why we've got the bill in, so it's £500 just for the people who need it most.
I think the central point and necessity for this bill is that the provisions of the Public Health Scotland Act 2008 were designed for what I would call isolated requirements of self-isolation. So they were envisaged for perhaps an E. coli outbreak in a small locality, or a case of that nature, where I think in general over the years there's been about 30 payments made by under the terms of the Public Health Scotland Act 2008 in these circumstances. The Act was not designed for a pandemic, because the Act requires each individual case to be assessed. So not only would the Public Health Scotland Act 2008 provisions provide for a much larger cost on the public purse, it would also be administratively overwhelming for the National Health Service. And the National Health Service is currently absolutely focused on dealing with the pandemic, the wider delivery of healthcare services. For it to then have to deploy massive administrative resources on the evaluation of cases consistent with the Public Health Scotland Act 2008, it would frankly overwhelm it. So we've had to make a pragmatic decision to essentially make payment available to those who require it in a sustainable way, both financially and administratively, for the National Health Service. That's why this bill is a necessity.
Okay, I mean, I think I'm certainly convinced by that argument. I think the committee probably is as well. So my final question then would be, does that mean the 2008 Act is not entirely fit for purpose? And do you think we need to revisit that legislation?
I think we've got to be clear that the 2008 Act is fit for the purpose it was designed for, which is isolated examples of self-isolation. It is not fit for purpose for pandemic financial support, which is why we have to put in place this legislation. So in that sense, Mr. Mason's point is a valid point, that the legislation has its purpose, but its purpose doesn't meet the circumstances of a global pandemic with the requirement for self-isolation that we are currently experiencing.
So, I mean, therefore, going forward, I mean, one of our aims is how can we be better prepared for the next pandemic? Is it worth, once we get through COVID, I'm not suggesting immediately, but would it be worthwhile looking at that Act to see that it's ready both for the isolated cases and for pandemics in future?
I think that's a reasonable point for us to consider, and to make sure that we have in place the appropriate long-term arrangements. None of us want to have another pandemic. You know, this one is absolutely overwhelming as it is, but we have to, and the committee's purpose, of course, is to look at the issues of COVID recovery and the questions that arise from that. So I think that's a reasonable point for us.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence. I will now suspend to allow a changeover of officials. We shall now move on to agenda item number 2. The committee will take evidence from the Scottish Government on the latest ministerial statement on COVID-19 and subordinate legislation. I welcome back to the meeting the Deputy First Minister and the following Scottish Government officials: Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director; Penelope Cooper, Interim Director of COVID Coordination; and Derek Grieve, Head of Operational Vaccine Division. Welcome and thank you for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move to questions?
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters, including updates to Parliament this week and last week on COVID-19. As the First Minister set out on Tuesday, Omicron is spreading rapidly and presents a significant challenge. We know that Omicron is significantly more transmissible than Delta. As it becomes the dominant strain, its much higher R number will also dominate and will drive a steeper increase in cases. It is important to be clear that even if Omicron does prove to be milder than Delta in terms of severe illness, a much more transmissible infection is likely to place a significant burden on the National Health Service. More people infected will result in more serious illness, and tragically, more people will die as a consequence. A significant rise in cases will also result in many more people being off work due to mild illness and isolation. The impact on the economy and our ability to deliver critical services will also be severe. This is why we must take Omicron extremely seriously and respond appropriately to mitigate its impacts on our society and economy. Our vaccination programme is central to our response. Getting fully vaccinated is the best thing we can do to protect ourselves and our loved ones. Scotland remains the most vaccinated part of the United Kingdom, and we are taking steps to deliver boosters even faster. This is the Scottish Government's top priority. Everyone aged over 18 can now book their booster through the online portal. Our aim is that everyone who is eligible will be able to book an appointment by the 31st of December. In addition to vaccination, the Scottish Government has introduced some further necessary and proportionate protective measures necessary to slow the spread of Omicron. We are requiring businesses, service providers and places of worship to take reasonable measures to minimise the incidence and spread of coronavirus. Guidance will be issued this week to make clear what this means for different sectors, but this will include physical distancing and other protective measures and enabling staff to work from home wherever possible. First Minister outlined additional support that is being made available for businesses, particularly in hospitality and food supply, affected by advice regarding work at Christmas parties. We will work to make this support available as soon as possible. We are also asking everyone to reduce their interactions with others as much as possible and limit the number of households meeting together to a maximum of 3. Omicron has a very high attack rate, which means that if just one person in a gathering is infectious, they are likely to infect many more people in the group than was the case with the Delta variant. Reducing the numbers of people and households gathering together will help to limit the extent of its spread. The First Minister made clear that Christmas is not in any way cancelled, and we're not asking people to change their plans for Christmas Day or Christmas Eve or Boxing Day if that's when they celebrate. We want people to be able to celebrate with their loved ones safely as possible. This means we all need to limit the number of people and households we meet indoors, take a lateral flow test regularly, wear face coverings properly when required, maintain good hygiene, work from home wherever possible, and ventilate indoor spaces. And very happy to answer questions the committee may have.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. Due to the developments of the new variant this week, I know that members have got a lot of questions for this session. So could I ask that witnesses are mindful of time when answering questions? All members will have around about 10 minutes each. If I could ask the first question, Deputy First Minister. In the last 24 hours, we've seen record numbers of COVID cases reported since the pandemic began. The committee last week had a very sobering briefing with our advisers that made a variety of suggestions on a range of issues which may assist us going forward through what we know is going to be a very difficult winter. And I understand that this could cross over onto the Health Cabinet Secretary's remit, but the suggestions that were made were that we need to train up more vaccinators as a matter of urgency to free up doctors and nurses to roll out the booster, and also to look at to limit bed blocking in hospital over the winter. It was suggested to train up people who could help with care over the winter months. Of course, training and disclosure would need to be in place. Are these the kind of things that the government are looking at to get us through this difficult winter?
These are measures that are actively being pursued, Convener. The committee will be familiar that the government has already recruited 350 full-time equivalent additional vaccinators. As a consequence of the decisions that we took at the weekend and on Tuesday, we are accelerating the vaccination programme, which means that we need to ensure more vaccinators are available to deliver vaccinations. There is that will of necessity require us to prioritise vaccination over other aspects of activity within the health service, and so that capacity is increasing. I think if we look at the data yesterday, about 77,000 Tuesday, 77,000 vaccinations were undertaken. Some of which, 18,000 of which, were flu vaccinations. The government has taken the decision to deprioritise the flu vaccination programme because we've got to very high levels of flu vaccination in the most vulnerable categories. We believe it's clinically safe risk to take by deprioritising the remainder of the flu vaccination programme. That frees up capacity within the vaccination, the COVID vaccination programme. We need to basically get to about 75,000 to 80,000 vaccinations a day on COVID to fulfil our objectives. So on the combination of COVID and flu, we were at 77,000 on Tuesday. Now, we need to increase the tempo of that because obviously there'll be days where it's difficult for us to deliver that volume of, you know, Christmas breaks and all that goes with it. So we are expanding that capacity, and the vaccination programme, Derek Grieve is the operational director of the vaccination programme who's on the line. He may wish to add to what I've said. On the question of delayed discharge, there is an intense focus on trying to support individuals who don't need to be in hospital to be released, to be supported at home. I have to be candid with the committee. The availability of social care staff is a challenge in that respect. Some people quite simply cannot be released from hospital to be sent home without a care package. And I discussed just last night with local authority leaders, and the health secretary has been doing this as well, the steps to be taken to expand at-home care capacity. And so that work is underway. But I have to be open with the committee that there are challenges in relation to the availability of social care staff to support that number of packages at local level. And perhaps Derek Grieve might want to add to my comments on the vaccination programme.
Can I bring in Derek Grieve?
Happy to. As you've outlined, DFM, I think there's a whole range of work underway to accelerate the booster programme. It's probably fair to say that on Tuesday, with the latest stats, that was our biggest volume of boosters delivered. So I think that demonstrates that some of the work that has been undertaken, such as the additional workforce that's been alluded to, and even since the last few weeks, we now understand there's going to be an additional 100 military personnel deployed, which adds even further to those vaccinators. As well as the seasonal flu activity that the Deputy First Minister set out, we're also making changes to things like the post-vaccine observation period. So at the moment, there was a 15-minute observation period for those that had a homologous vaccine of mRNA. That's being reduced to 5 minutes. So all of these little measures, although they may appear to be marginal, they do allow us to increase overall capacity and throughput and allow us to accelerate. And finally, I just say that as well as all of that, local health boards are working with local authorities to increase facilities, and there's lots of work going on, not just extending the duration and opening hours of existing clinics, but also identifying new ones. As for example, we know Glasgow's bringing on Hamden next week, and Edinburgh is bringing on the EICC again. So some of those mass settings that were planned and undertaken previously are now being brought back into play and stood up at pace.
That's great. Thanks very much. Just with my next question for the Deputy First Minister, if I may, It's really around consistency in messaging since the last announcement. There does seem to be a lot of confusion from the general public, and I'm sure all members have received these in their inbox in the last week, whereas we have been told that we should limit ourselves to three households, but then people can still go to a nightclub or go to a concert and mingle with thousands. And also we've got the education setting, which we've had a lot of public questions onto the website regarding education. And the last winter, I know that our teenagers had a very challenging winter because they weren't allowed to socialise inside, so they took to going outside by crowds. And I've had lots of parents in touch asking what numbers can children meet outside out with school. So there doesn't seem to be consistency at the moment, and I appreciate you said there will be some guidance coming out this week, but just to sort of try and get some more clarity on what people should be doing.
What we're trying to do, Kavira, is to engage the public in a communal effort to reduce the level of social interaction that undertakes. We all know that social interaction is the route by which the virus spreads. So we all are involved in some degree of social interaction, and the government's plea is that we should reduce that. And what we're trying to do is to do that consistent with a context in which, quite clearly, the well-being of individuals in our society is suffering during COVID. So the loss of opportunities to go to events that are significant for people is a big loss for individuals. So I was questioned on the radio yesterday about people going to the pantomime. Now, you know, the pantomime is a landmark occasion in lots of families' annual calendars. And I would essentially say to people, look, if you're going to the pantomime, where you will be sitting alongside other people, first of all, get a lateral flow test before you go, make sure you don't have COVID, be vaccinated, wear your face covering, stay safe. But as a result, limit your other social interaction and reduce that so that you can have the events in your family calendar that we all cherish, but essentially reduce the amount of other social interaction to ensure that your conduct is not contributing towards the potential spread of the virus. So there is a necessity for individuals to limit their social interaction, and that then affects the use. So that's why we're not saying to people in a blanket kind of way, return to your houses and don't come out, because we're trying to recognise the damage to well-being that has been done by 20 months of this pandemic. We're trying to be as pragmatic as we can. Now, you asked me specifically about the education system, Convener. And the government has taken a decision in principle that we want to protect the sustainability of education for as long as we possibly can do. So education will be the last part of our public services to be required to, or the last part of our measures to be restricted because of the importance of supporting the education of young people. In relation to the socialisation of individuals outside their homes and young people, I would say to limit those numbers as much as individuals can do, given the prevalence of Omicron.
Thank you very much. Can I just one quick question, and this is from a member of the public, if I could ask this to Jason Leach, and it's from concerned citizen in Aberdeenshire. What evidence is there to support the Scottish Government new definition, which means that someone who has been in a classroom with a positive case for more than 15 minutes is no longer considered to be high risk of transmission? Could I ask Jason Leach that question?
Morning, Convener. Thank you for having me. Nice to see you all again. These are risk-based judgments. We've had four variants, and we've had multiple versions of the self-isolation rules because we have to adapt to the variant and the stage of the pandemic. At this stage of the Delta and Omicron outbreaks across the country, we've made risk-based judgments about self-isolation. So for now, that is quite harsh on household contacts, for instance, and we're not requiring non-household contacts to go in their houses for 10 days. They can have a positive test, a negative test rather, and be released. Schools are, again, risk-based. They're about close contact. And those are judged by local health protection teams generically initially. So there is guidance, general guidance about what to do. And then local health protection teams are available for more detailed guidance about whether it was a school bus or whether it was a sporting event or whether it was just everybody in the classroom. I'm afraid blanket advice has to be just that. It has to be blanket advice. That self-isolation advice is looked at all the time for adults and children and settings like schools and theatres and prisons and everywhere else. And we adapt according to the disease we're facing and the stage of the pandemic we're at.
Thank you, Professor Leach. I'll move on to members' questions now. Can I move on to Murdo Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning again, Cabinet Secretary, and welcome to the officials. The two issues I'd like to raise this morning. Firstly, and to pick up on your opening statement, I think the public are increasingly aware to the risks from Omicron. I think it's very encouraging to see so many people coming forward now for boosters and people being aware of the risks of mixing with others. I think that's good. At the same time, I think we are all aware that Christmas is just over 1 week away, and a lot of people have already made their plans for Christmas to see family and friends. And I think there will be some concern at the prospect that these Christmas plans, which have already been put in place, might be disrupted by any further new restrictions brought in over the next week. So can I ask, is there a real prospect of any stricter rules being brought in that will affect the Christmas period?
We'd dearly love to be able to rule that out, but I can't in all honesty do that at this stage. Mr. Fraser is absolutely right about the severity of the situation that we face, and I welcome his acknowledgement at that point. I also entirely accept his point that I think the public are responding accordingly to the challenge. I think we all look at evidence, but we also are all influenced by anecdotes. I have to say, I have noticed that my journeys into Edinburgh on Tuesday and Thursday this week have both been much easier in traffic volumes than last week, and today was significantly easier than Tuesday was, which suggests to me that more people are working from home and fewer are commuting. So I think the public are responding. I hope that we can avoid applying any further constraints on the way in which people are able to enjoy Christmas. But the message that the First Minister issued on Tuesday was very deliberately positioned to say to people, if we want to be able to carry on with our family plans around about Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, Boxing Day, whatever people celebrate accordingly, the best and safest way to do that is to prepare well for that by making sure that we're all COVID-free and that we lateral flow test before we gather in family groupings, but that we also reduce our social interaction before and after that period. And I think that's the safest way to proceed, but I have to acknowledge that given the rapid pace of increase of Omicron cases and the data that was shared by the Prime Minister and the Chief Medical Officer in the United Kingdom yesterday reinforces the points that the First Minister was making on Tuesday about the severity of the threat. I cannot rule out that we might have to apply further constraints in the period ahead.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, that's a very clear answer, and I appreciate it. My one follow-up then is, what would be the last date on which any additional restrictions might be announced that would impact on Christmas?
Again, that's a difficult question for me to be precise about. We are reviewing the situation on a constant basis. We are looking at many data streams about levels of infection, about pressures on our hospitals, about the effectiveness of the vaccination programme. So there are many factors that can be borne in mind. I think what I would say to people at this stage is that the advice that's been given so far about reducing social interaction before and after the Christmas period is the most effective contribution people can make towards ensuring that we can enjoy and appreciate some time with our families over the what we might call the formal Christmas period. And obviously the government will be very mindful of the fact that the last thing they want to do is to inflict disruption on people at this time. It sadly had to happen last year. We want to avoid it, if at all possible, this year, and we will be very mindful of the plans that people will have been made in any decision making that we undertake.
Okay, thank you for that. And my second question is on a slightly different topic, and it's around the regulations that are to be introduced from tomorrow, which were announced to the Parliament on Tuesday by the First Minister, and which a draft has been shared with us. And the regulations which relate to businesses and indeed other venues such as places of worship will, according to the regulations, the draft regulations we're looking at, referred to guidance being issued by Scottish ministers, and say that those responsible for these businesses must have regard to that guidance. So my question is, where is this guidance and how do people access it?
The guidance is being formulated as we speak. Given the nature and the pace at which we are operating, we are trying to discuss with a variety of interested parties the detail of that guidance. I expect it to be available in the course of Friday, and it will essentially provide the information that those that are obliged to have reference to that guidance are able to take forward. You know, we need to consult with the business community, we need to consult with faith leaders, we need to consult with other relevant organisations. That work is underway, so that we can try to do this to the greatest extent possible in a manner and a fashion that enables continued activity to take place, but in a way that is contributing towards the reduction of the possibility of the circulation of the virus.
Right. Thank you for that clarity. I mean, the regulations do say that they come into force on the 17th, which is tomorrow, and you're saying the guidance will not be available until tomorrow. I mean, I appreciate the need to consult with those affected, but it's not giving people very much time to access the guidance and implement it if the regulations are coming into force on the very day that the guidance is being published.
But I appreciate that, and I can only say that the government is having to respond swiftly to a changing situation. That has been the nature and the manner of our experience over COVID. Omicron has advanced at a frightening level and a frightening rate, and we are having to take measures swiftly, and the guidance has been formulated equally swiftly. We will endeavour to publish that guidance as quickly as we possibly can do. There's obviously dialogue going on, but the headline messages that we have issued are about indicating to various organisations, be they in the retail sector or places of worship or the hospitality sector, measures with which these organisations will be familiar. And we certainly are mindful of the need to ensure that we provide clarity in that guidance, and that's what the government is endeavouring to do.
Okay, thank you. And finally, convener, just on this point, the regulations, as I read them, say that persons must have regard to guidance. That doesn't sound to me like putting a legal obligation on businesses or places of worship to follow them. Is that correct?
Mr. Fraser is a lawyer, unlike me, but as a legislator, I would say that have regard to places an obligation on those organisations to heed the contents of the guidance. And in the spirit of how we have tried to embark on the whole approach to the management of COVID, I would invite organisations to follow up that obligation, which I would consider to be a legal obligation, to have regard to that guidance.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Can we please move on to John Mason, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. And I think my first point is possibly for Jason Leach. We've been given some advice that February is going to be the real crunch month for infections and hospitalisations and so on. Is that what we're currently expecting?
The huge challenge here is that the virus's timing is horrid. We've had four variants, two of which have come 4 weeks before Christmas. So the fact we're having to have conversations about Christmas socialising again is horrid for all of us. The other challenge is not only its timing of arrival, but its incubation period and the gap between infection and disease that causes hospitalisation or death. And that is longer with this virus than we would hope, because it's easier to control almost if the incubation period is faster. There's no real science yet to say Omicron varies much from Delta. It might have a slightly shorter incubation period, but we don't have the numbers to know that for sure. So the average is 3 to 5 days between meeting the virus and having a symptom, 2 weeks to end up in hospital, and then horribly another 2 weeks if you're in the very small number of people who then might unfortunately need intensive care and perhaps even die once you reach there. So if you work out where the wave is, so the wave is, we're at the foothills of the wave just now, which is why we're asking people to help us control that wave as much as they can. That would suggest peak in January. That would suggest peak hospitalizations 2 weeks after that peak. But remember, this isn't a single day. It is a curve. So the curve of hospitalization comes afterwards, but you will see a peak in that hospitalizations. And then, unfortunately, in intensive care and death. The one still really much unknown about this variant is how many hospitalizations lead to intensive care and death, because we just haven't had enough time yet. We don't have enough disease around the world and enough time to get there. Early signs from Scandinavia are unfortunately not encouraging. The number of hospitalizations has shot up in Scandinavia. And even if, as the Deputy First Minister said at the beginning, even if the hospitalisation rate is half of Delta, the numbers are going to be so high that we're still going to be in trouble.
Okay, thanks for that. That's helpful. Maybe my second question then would be for John Swinney. Clearly, I mean, finance is an issue in this, because we don't have the money to compensate businesses if we close them. So I'm just wondering if we can do more with other measures. And I mean, for example, we've previously talked about rolling out the vaccine certificates more widely. And I mentioned the other day that I was at theatre on Saturday night. Now, there was only 1,500, I think, there, so it wouldn't have been covered by the certificates. But the theatre group, which I thought was great, were insisting on either a negative test or a vaccinations. And I have to say, the whole thing went very smoothly. They checked us in the line. People had time to then switch their phone to their ticket so that they could get in the door. And there was no negative reaction I could see to that at all. So, I mean, is it possible, would a useful measure be to roll out the certificates a bit more widely? And secondly, on that one, masks. I think you know, it has varied a lot about people wearing masks. And I think some places have been very good. And again, the theatre, virtually everybody wore the mask. But, you know, the trains, I think, have been very poor at asking people, not telling people, asking people to wear masks. The railway companies are just saying, oh, it's up to British Transport Police. We can't do anything. And I just wonder if there's others like that who could be encouraged to push the masks a bit more.
On the first question about vaccine certification, the Cabinet considered whether we should extend vaccine certification to a wider range of settings. But their judgment was that the appropriateness of that step at this stage, when we know that the existing vaccinations that individuals have undertaken need to be boosted by the booster vaccination for them to be effective against Omicron, does not make that a justifiable move, because it puts on a requirement which it would be difficult to demonstrate was providing robust protection with the advent of Omicron. And Omicron is a, you know, last 2 weeks development that we now have. So there may be a moment where that becomes relevant, but the Cabinet decided at this stage it was not. The second point on mask wearing is absolutely fundamental. And I think the point that Mr. Mason makes is completely justified. Wearing a mask is, frankly, the least thing anyone should be perturbed about. I appreciate for some people there are health issues and they can't wear it. But for everybody else, there should be no question about it, because it is demonstrated by global research, by the policies of the World Health Organization and the advice of the World Health Organization, to be a significant deterrent to the circulation of the virus. So people wearing face coverings is fundamental. Now, I certainly will take away from this call the need to reinforce to transport providers, on the basis of what Mr. Mason has put to me, the need to remind people of the necessity of wearing face coverings on public transport. I don't think it's an issue that can just be left to British Transport Police to enforce. There should be constant messaging to the effect of that, and I will take that issue away. It's an issue that Cabinet has reflected on before and which it believes to be an important part of the protection in place.
Okay, thanks very much for that. There's so much. Maybe just a quick question against yourself, Deputy First Minister, on the inquiry. As I understand it, the inquiry is going to go up to the 31st of December 22. Can you tell us why that particular date was chosen? It's obviously in the future.
Basically, because we think the pandemic is still with us very much just now. We are still taking decisions about the handling of the pandemic, and we will be doing that well into 2022. So we decided to put a timescale of that nature on for two reasons. Firstly, to define a structure for the period. It can't be unending, the period of scrutiny or the inquiry. You know, we'll just frankly never report. So there has to be a defined time frame. And we didn't want to limit that to too great an extent without providing the scope for the inquiry to look at the overall handling of the pandemic. So that was the justification for the timeframe that we have set out.
Thank you. And my final point, convener, and I realise this is touching on a reserve matter, but we had a briefing from, amongst others, Oxfam and Christian Aid about the vaccines getting to poorer countries around the world. And I mean, one of the figures they gave was that only 7.1% of people in low-income countries have received at least one dose. So I mean, the gap between them and us is just absolutely huge. And they're arguing that it's not just the existing companies producing more vaccines, it should be about allowing the developing countries to produce them themselves by allowing the intellectual property rights to be waived. Is there anything the Scottish Government can do to kind of push this agenda along?
This is an issue that the First Minister has taken forward with the United Kingdom government to try to make progress on the legitimate issues that Mr Mason puts to me. It's great that there is effort and measures in place across the globe to protect all populations, and the disparity between developed and developing countries is frankly indefensible. So there has to be a combined global effort to enable this to be the case, and the First Minister certainly has given her support to these endeavours. She's engaged with these organisations, made those representations to the United Kingdom government, and we will continue to do so.
Thank you. Can we please move on to Brian Whittle?
Mr Swinney and others on the call. I raised this this morning, actually, with a debrief around consistency of messaging. I think driving in this morning, I think myself and a couple of colleagues were listening to a radio programme where very legitimate, where, you know, putting forward their thoughts on Omicron virus coming out of South Africa, whether it was particularly virulent, whether we should, one was saying that we needed a circuit breaker. And this sort of, these experts clashing or bumping heads with each other, I think, and we can tell this by the postbacks that we get and their constituents' phone calls, that there's a lack of understanding, really, of where we're going with this, what this Omicron virus means. How do we get a much more consistent messaging together? Because it impacts potential compliance, impacts with people's, and I've raised this before around the almost anger, inability to access public services, NHS services. How do we get this consistency across to the general public so that there's this maximum amount of compliance? I'll put that first to the Deputy First Minister, if I could.
The necessity of handling this matter in a dispassionate, evidence-based approach is absolutely critical. Throughout the pandemic, we have listened with care to expert opinion on this matter. Now, as Mr Whittle is absolutely correct, there are some experts that will debate some of these elements, but I'm satisfied that we have had from our chief medical officers and our senior advisors a body of well-considered, thoughtful and accurate advice on the nature of the pandemic. If we look at the current situation that we face, anyone looking at the briefing that was given last night by Professor Chris Whitty, the United Kingdom chief medical officer, and then looking at the guidance, the evidence presented by our own chief medical officer, national clinical director, and their teams, that advice is absolutely consistent. So the idea that somehow there is a lack of clarity or consistency in the messaging about the severity of the threat that we face, I think is a point I would not accept. I think that's clearly marshalled for the public to see. I think the question then becomes, what do you do in the light of that advice? And that's where I think we have got some genuine difficulties, because the First Minister was clear on Tuesday she would have liked us to have gone further, but we are constrained from going further because of the ability, or the lack of ability on our part, to be able to adequately compensate people who would be affected by those decisions. That's not me in any way making a partisan remark. It's a recognition of the reality that the measures that we would think appropriate for the gravity of these circumstances is not reflected in decision-making that enables us to act from the United Kingdom government, despite the fact that the clinical and epidemiological advice that is going to us and going to the United Kingdom government is absolutely consistent about the severity of the threat we face.
Well, and that, can I just follow up that very point there, Mr. Spinney? You said earlier on that you are having to act on a very fast-moving and changing picture. That, of course, is exactly the same for every other government, all of our governments across the world, which would then suggest to me that there's this need for the Westminster government and the devolved governments to work ever closer together. Therefore, they can have a consistent approach across that. So, where are we with that? Is that happening? Are we able to put, as you said, Chris Whitty, I was very pleased to hear his messaging as well. Are we working together across the United Kingdom to create this same approach, if you like?
There are elements which I think are strong. The vaccination programme is an area of very strong collaboration, of joint purpose, of absolutely consistent messaging. If you're over 18, get yourself booking a booster jag and do it pronto, and we're expanding capacity and all that goes with that. So there is absolute consistency and approach between the Scottish and United Kingdom governments on that question. In terms of the advice that we are receiving, I would say that I heard nothing from Chris Whitty last night that I'm not hearing with the same gravity from the Chief Medical Officer or the National Clinical Director in Scotland. I think what's unfortunately, however, is the case is a difference of opinion about the scale of response required to that in policy terms. Where I think it would be fair to say the Scottish, Welsh and Northern Ireland governments all share a common position that we should be going further than we have currently gone, but that's not shared by the United Kingdom government. Now there's dialogue about that. The First Minister was involved in a further Four Nations call last night, been involved in Four Nations calls on several occasions in the course of the last few days, on Sunday and earlier on last week, but that is not producing a meeting of minds about the scale of the response that is required, other than on some of the questions like vaccination. And that's welcome, but I think we could benefit from further alignment and for a greater set of measures, given the gravity of the situation that we face.
Just taking that a little bit further, the First Minister announced yesterday an extra £100 million pounds had been good, if you like, out of the Scottish budget to try and tackle COVID. And then there's a further £220 million now been announced coming from Westminster. So that's £320 million. What is the ask then? If it's not £320 million, what is the ask? How short are we in terms of what the Scottish government would like to do?
Well, first of all, I need to delve into the figures. The £100 million has come out of existing Scottish government resources to support the hospitality sector. That's reprioritisation that we've undertaken, and there'll be some discomfort and some pain about that in the remainder of the financial year. And the £220 million is not additional money. We had been expecting to receive £265 million in UK consequentials, and we factored them into our financial planning. The Treasury have confirmed that we're getting not £265 million, but £220 million. So we're actually receiving less than we anticipated and have factored into our budgeting. The issue that Mr. Whittle puts to me is about what's the nature and the scale of the response required. And I think we have to get into the point that I've been trying to make over the last few days is that we need to be able to protect livelihoods. That's been our strategic approach throughout the pandemic. We take measures to suppress the virus and we protect livelihoods while we do so. And to an extent, we've been able to do that up until now, hugely because of the support of the furlough scheme from the UK government, really valuable underpinning of the response up until now. But of course, the furlough scheme has come to an end. And if we were to apply further restrictions on the ability of people to work or to run businesses, that would undoubtedly give rise to further financial challenges for those individuals or businesses. And we quite simply don't have the means by which we, the financial means by which we could compensate for that or ameliorate the effect of it. £100 million will help, but from the Scottish Government's resources, but that's all we've got to deploy in this particular situation. So therefore, a recognition that, and this is a plea that's been made not just by the Scottish Government, but by the Welsh Government and the Northern Irish Government, for us to be able to have access to financial flexibilities to enable us to act in that way.
Thank you. Can I ask, finally, just ask a question to Professor Leach, if I could. I think the concern that a lot has been discussed around the pressure that's going to be put on the NHS, but that's not necessarily about hospitalisation. It's around the public. Public services being affected by absenteeism due to COVID. We're seeing that happen in increasing numbers. Are you concerned that pressure of the Omicron and the rise of the Omicron, the speed of the rise of the Omicron, is going to put unnecessary and more pressure on an NHS than it can cope with?
Yes, I am, frankly, not just of our health and social care system, but also many other elements of our society, public and private services. You cannot have the predicted wave that we're going to have without it putting people in their houses, either themselves or looking after relatives or looking after kids who are working in our society and not have an effect. It is impossible unless you reduce the wave, which is why we're trying to reduce the wave. So yes, there is a perfect storm, which we've mentioned many times at this committee, of COVID, winter, and postponed care. And postponed care, when it turns up, forgive the kind of impersonal nature of this, but postponed care when it turns up is often worse than if you'd got it the first time. So it takes longer. People need more care. People need more tests. So all of that jams up the system, and the more we stop, the more we have to pay back as time passes. And even if this disease, and I'd say again, we do not know, even if this disease doesn't cause as many hospitalizations and deaths, don't believe social media. Social media doesn't know if it is less severe. Even if it is less severe, then the sheer weight of numbers of those either positive or self-isolating will cause a significant challenge to our public services. It's important to say that we do have exemptions to some of those rules in critical national infrastructure, including health and social care, retail, some essential retail, some other elements of our society like electricity supply. But it's only for those who are fully vaccinated, and it's only in those industries. Again, we'll look at the self-isolation rules as we learn more, but for now, we need to try and slow the wave, and self-isolation and interrupting the chains of transmission is the most important thing we can do, bar getting everybody vaccinated.
Thank you, convener. My time is up a few.
Hello.
We can hear you.
You can hear me. Grant, thank you very much. Good morning, Mr. Swinney and Mr. Leach, and all of your staff that are with you. Just, Mr. Leach, just following up on what you've just said, in terms of workers being allowed to go back to work, do you have a scheme already in place to allow essential workers to get back out to work as long as they are vaccinated at the moment? Is that already in place? Do people know about it?
I'm I'm sorry, Professor Leach, she seemed to be on mute.
So there are two systems, Mr. Fehling. One is a blanket exemption for health and social care frontline workers, which all of those in charge of health and social care know about and are activating. There is another one, which is it's the same as we had before, called the critical national infrastructure process, and it is application. So if you have a food distribution system that is absolutely essential for public services, or if you are an electricity supply company or a funeral director, et cetera, you can apply, and that process now is faster than it was before because we have the history that we already had, and that guidance is online and available.
Okay, how extensive is it? Does it go to a food business for shelf stalkers, for instance?
You have to prove essentialness. I'm not sure that's a word, but you have to prove that your particular part of the puzzle is essential. The definition of essential, of course, is in the eye of the beholder. Let's remember what we're trying to do here. This is a compromise. The public health advice is isolate all contacts, if you possibly can, because you want to interrupt the chains of transmission. But the other harms, the harms of running a country for health and social care, for essential infrastructure, mean that we have to have exemptions. Otherwise, other harms will overtake us. So the public health advice is to move that bar to more safety. The business advice is to move that bar further along. The truth is somewhere in between those two, and that's why there's a process to make those judgments.
Okay, thank you. We'll make essentialness a new word for COVID. Can also stick with yourself just now, Jason, on the value of using other countries' experiences for us to work out the strength or the nastiness of this disease. You know, I know that we've had the South African system, and it's now promulgated widely that it's not nearly as dangerous, but that's because of a different demographic. How do we get the message of what's happening for us here in Scotland?
It's an excellent question, Mr. Fehling. You have to be careful about extrapolation from other countries' experience into ours. It is a dangerous game to take one country and say this is how this virus behaves. In general terms, I think I've said this before here, in very, very general terms, South Africa is younger, poorer, and less vaccinated. So all of those dials are different from our set of dials. Norway and Denmark, richer, as vaccinated, et cetera, et cetera. So you have to adapt what you see in other countries to your environment. The best data you can get is, of course, your own, but we look constantly. The South Africans have been hugely open and helpful. They're doing daily press conferences. They're also doing private briefings for other countries. Their genetic sequencing has been hugely helpful. So I have nothing but praise for the South African public health system in their help to the world, particularly when this variant became apparent. The other big challenge you have in South Africa is they have a mixed delivery system. They have a private and a public system. So when you look at the data, you have to be very careful about which sector it came from. Did it come from their private insurance healthcare system, which is a legitimate and good system, or did it come from their slightly more challenged and, in general terms, poorer public system? And therefore, the data you see has to be seen through that lens. We have the WHO helping with that, and we have the European Centre for Disease Control helping for that, and, of course, our own scientists and analysts looking at that. And the advice we give to the Deputy First Minister and the First Minister goes through the lens of adapting it to what we're seeing from other countries. That's how we know it's more transmissible. It looks as though with a fair wind, it might be slightly less severe, but we don't know. And it might still respond to vaccination, but we know it definitely responds to booster vaccination. So we've got some knowledge, and every day we get more.
Okay, thank you for that. I lost the tail end of that, but I've got one last question. It's a very quick one, I hope, because I've been asked to ask this by a healthcare professional. Given the virulence and the transmissibility of this, should we be asking people to wear an FFP2 type mask. Now, I don't know what that is. I've just been asked to ask that question.
So there are grades of face coverings, from FFP3, which is the ones you see in intensive care, through FFP2, which are the kind of black or white ones that have usually have a margin along the centre. You won't be surprised to know my answer is to ask the experts, as we do with a number of these difficult questions. We have a group of four country experts and Scottish experts. In fact, the four country committee is run by one of our professors of infection and prevention control, and they look at this constantly. Their advice for now is not to change the advice for the general population. These masks need a bit of work. They need to be worn a very particular way. It's not about supply. We could do it if we had to, but the advice from the expert group on infection and prevention control is reinforce the messaging around wearing face coverings well and wearing the three-layer fabric or the fluid-resistant ones, the blue ones that you can now buy pretty much everywhere, and use them well in the population, and reserve the FFP2 and FFP3 for healthcare settings.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to move on to Mr. Swinney now. We've had a public question here, and this isn't the final part of my question. I just want to tie it into something else. What funds will be made available to support the third sector organisations who support health and social care and have been greatly impacted by the pandemic? That's part one. You talked about care packages that are required for getting people out of hospital and back home. Now, my own father took COVID. He's now having severe problems with COVID delirium, and he's still in hospital, and he will be until such time as that delirium clears. Now, we can't get a care package that would fit to take him home, which again is going to be very expensive. And Brian Whittle there talked about the funding, the extra £220 million that is coming to the Scottish Government. And I'm not trying to make a political point here, but my understanding is that that's not extra funding. That's an advance from money that will be coming, that should be coming from later on in the financial year. So what impact will using that money now in the healthcare setting have on later on? And I do want to come back quickly about the finances for the hospitality sector as well, if we get time, convener. Mr. Smith, John Smith.
First of all, in relation to the flows of money from the United Kingdom government, as I explained in my answer to Brian Quittle, the Scottish government had been expecting the United Kingdom government to allocate consequentials to us from other decisions in the UK to the tune of £265 million. We didn't have absolute confirmation of that, but that was our estimate, and we have factored that into our financial planning for this year and next year. What the United Kingdom government announced in the course of the last 24 hours or so is that that number will not be £265 million, it will be £220 million. Now, what that says is two things. One is that we are receiving less money than we were expecting. And then secondly, there is no new money come from the UK government. This was all expected and it's been factored into our planning. So there is no new money come from the UK government funding announcement. Second point I would make is in relation to the delivery of care packages and the support for the third sector. Obviously, the government is allocating resources. We've given additional funding to the delivery of social care within Scotland, substantial increases in the money for social care packages. That money is available in some circumstances to be used by local authorities, in other circumstances delivered by third sector organisations who will be acting under contract from local authorities through health and social care partnership. So there are opportunities for the third sector to receive financial support through the delivery of increased social care resources that the Scottish Government has put in place. The challenge, however, is about the availability of people to deliver those social care packages. And in the communities that Mr. Fairley and I both represent in Perthshire, we both will be hearing from, well, we both are hearing from organisations about the challenge of, in this particular circumstance, not necessarily the availability of money, but the availability of people to deliver those social care packages. And of course, that has a significant bearing on the question of delayed discharge, because the last thing we want is people being in hospital, such as Mr. Fairley's father, who could be being supported at home with a care package, but we can't do that because we don't have the people to deliver these social care packages on the ground. And that's about wider issues with which we are all familiar, which arise out of the loss of free movement of individuals and other challenges.
Thank you. Mr. Fairley, I know that you want to come in on another question, but could we just move to Alex Rowley, and if we have time, we'll come back to you at the end.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Mr. Swinney, you've constantly talked about the importance of acting proportionately and acting appropriately in terms of measures to mitigate. But I'm not convinced that the current announcements that we've had actually are appropriate to the scale of the problems that we face. I don't think you have to be an expert if you have looked at the evidence of the spread of this latest variant. I mean, you've got to be really worried. Professor Leach mentioned earlier about Omicron and the fact that some people say it's less a health risk, but you know, the evidence coming from Denmark, for example, is that hospitalisations are really running much higher. So when I heard the First Minister's statement on Tuesday, I suppose my surprise was that it was not going further. And you know, you talked earlier about pantomimes, and I understand that, but there's a big difference between a pantomime and going into a venue where alcohol has been consumed at fast rates, people are not socially distancing, people are dancing at this time of year, tend to cuddle up and whatever. There are real risks there, is there not? So are you acting, do you believe you're acting proportionately in terms of the level of risks? And will the failure to act now not result or have more chance of us resulting in a lockdown as we go into the new year?
These are frankly some of the central dilemmas that ministers wrestle with at all times, and I have been open with the committee that the Scottish Government would like to be taking more substantive measures, but we have to be mindful of our obligations across all of the various harms associated with COVID. If we take action to address the direct health harm of COVID, which is essentially the point that Mr. Rowley reasonably puts to me, that may result in social and economic harm to individuals in our society, which the government has got to be in a position to either defend as proportionate or to ameliorate by some form of compensatory intervention. And we are trying to maximise the compensatory interventions we are able to make by the resources we've allocated, but we would be in a stronger position if the same approach that we believe is necessary, which the Welsh Government believes is necessary, the Northern Ireland Government believes is necessary, was shared by the United Kingdom Government into the bargain. So that is candidly what is the challenge here, that we cannot align that scale of intervention. Now, that is, I've said to the committee that there may be circumstances in which the government has to take further action, and we may well have to because of the gravity of the situation, but we have to be cognizant of the various harms that individuals may suffer. If I could make one final point, Convener, and I might have made some of this point in the questions that Mr. Fairley raised with Professor Leach, but I am increasingly concerned about a notion being put about that Omicron is a less severe variant than Delta or other previous variants. This is a complete misnomer, because this, the transmissibility of Omicron, and this was the central point of my opening remarks to the committee, the transmissibility of Omicron will result in a discernibly higher level of cases in Scotland and other countries than has been the case before. We're seeing that in the daily numbers. I'm sure we'll see that again today. And even a small proportion of that much, 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 much larger number ending up in hospital is going to give us a severe challenge in our hospital system, and it will give us a severe challenge in the delivery of public and private services in the period to come.
The UK government, in my view, is trying to almost create this false myth that it is public health versus the economy. The economy will collapse if public health gets completely overrun by this variant. And I would suggest to you that it's not good enough for the Scottish Government to simply say the UK Government are not making the finances available. This UK Government becomes more discredited by the day, and therefore surely we in Scotland should expect a government to stand up to the UK Government, making clear that we cannot continue. There are certain sections of our economy right now that one way or another is going to end up shut. The problem is, if we don't move first, then the impact of that on our National Health Service as we go into the new year is going to overwhelm the National Health Service. So I would urge you to be much more forceful, and hopefully Wales and Northern Ireland will be the same, because we seem to have a Prime Minister in Downing Street who's got his fingers crossed, hoping for the best and not following the clear science that is coming out.
I understand entirely where Mr Rowley is coming from. I think he makes an entirely accurate point that if cases rise to such an extent that we are seeing happening, and that we fear and that our modelling suggests, then there will be a massive threat to the delivery of a range of public services, not just the National Health Service. The National Health Service will face colossal pressures, but the ability, our ability to deliver routine public services and private sector services will be severely impaired if Omicron develops on the worst case scenario that we believe to be the case. Hence, and I understand the pressure Mr Rowley puts on me for an assertive stance to be taken with the UK government. Believe you me, that is being done. It's been done publicly by the First Minister and by ministers. It has been done privately by the First Minister and ministers. At all times, we are wasting no opportunity of interaction to put this point to the UK government. In the Four Nations call last night, the First Minister reiterated these very, very strong arguments. First Minister of Wales did likewise, as did the First Minister of Northern Ireland and the Deputy First Minister of Northern Ireland. So these points are being made. They are being made forcefully to the United Kingdom government. So that is the approach we are taking. And we accept the gravity of the situation that we face. Let me finish this answer by saying that Mr Rowley and I come from different political stables, but he and I share many similar political outlooks. The conclusion I draw from all of this is that our Parliament should be able to take the necessary decisions to deal with all of the implications of the health emergency. That is my position, always has been my position. And I think the gravity of the situation we face just now, and Mr. Rowley's raising issues which require me to go into this territory in the committee evidence. The gravity of the situation demonstrates why this Parliament has to be able to have access to much more financial flexibility and responsibility than is currently the case.
Yeah, and I think you know, it highlights why there's an overwhelming case for greater borrowing powers. Could I shift now to social care? We now have urged the Deputy First Minister over a number of months now to look at putting a task force in regional by region to look at social care. I have raised previously, I do not have the confidence that there is the management capacity within health and social care partnerships to address the issues that's there. In the last week or two, I have met with a number of social care providers, and it's quite horrific listening to the challenges and the difficulties that they are facing. There needs to be a clearer strategy around recruitment and retention, but I have to say I was so disappointed when the budget was announced last week, because it is clear from all the evidence that not paying the rate for the job for social care workers is a key factor in retention and recruitment. I know Mr. Swinney will say to me about Brexit and free movement, but the fact is that the providers I've talked to don't highlight that as the key issue. It's an issue, but one of the key issues that we will have to resolve is not paying the rate for the job. Does Mr. Swinney accept, if this was a sector that was male dominated, does he accept that we would not be in this situation where people are not being paid the rate for the job? And therefore, will he accept that if we're going to tackle the so-called social care issues, we have to pay people the rate for the job?
Can we just move to the Deputy First Minister? I'm really conscious of time. We've only got several minutes left, Deputy First Minister.
Yeah, the government has increased the resources available for social care salaries, and I value the work that's undertaken. I do not think it's the issues that are raised by Mr. Rowley about the gender composition of the social care workforce are in any way a legitimate issue for that to drive these questions. We've taken steps to increase pay in the social care sector. We are facing, as a society, enormous challenges in the labour market across a range of sectors, of which the social care sector is one, about the volume and availability of people. So the government will continue to work with local authorities on this question and health and social care partnerships. Mr. Rowley suggested the concept of a task force to address these issues. I'm not convinced about that, because I simply think we've got to get on with delivering. We know what the problem is, and we've got to get on with delivering, and we need our health and social care partnerships to be supported to do that. And that's exactly what the Health Secretary and the Social Justice Secretary are doing to enable that to be the case.
But if management lack the capacity to actually address it, then there is a serious problem. Are you confident that social care partnerships across the country have the management capacity and the ability to address what is turning into a deep, deep crisis, getting worse by the week?
Yes, they should have that capacity, and they should be able to deliver that in all parts of the country, because our fellow citizens require the provision of such services, and people should only be exercising these roles in management and the organisation of these services if they are fit and capable to do so.
Thank you. That will conclude our consideration of this item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence today during these worrying times. We'll now move on to the third agenda item, which is consideration of motion on the made affirmative instruments during the previous agenda item. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSIs listed under agenda item number 2 before we take the motions?
It may help if I just simply place on the record some detail. Following the clinical concerns about the levels of Omicron variant being reported across Africa, the international travel instruments before the committee today reintroduced restrictions to allow the Joint Biosecurity Centre more time to engage with African authorities and access richer data to inform their risk assessment. The number 8, 9 and 11 instruments added 11 countries to the red list, in line with the latest UK Health Security Agency risk assessment, with changes agreed on a four-nation basis. Travellers from these countries are required to enter managed quarantine hotels on arrival into Scotland and to take tests on both day 2 and day 8 after their arrival. The number 10 regulations removed the option for travellers to take an LFD test and required that they must take a PCR test within the first 2 days of arriving into Scotland and self-isolate until the result of the test is known. The number 12 regulations reintroduced pre-departure testing for all travellers, regardless of vaccination status. and extended it to new groups, including some children previously not included. It also reduced the period from 3 days to 2 days within which a test can be taken before travel. As the committee is aware, the international travel rules are subject to regular review on a four nations basis, and this review took place at the start of this week. Temporary additions to the red list were proportionate as an immediate response to limit importation of the new variant, but the rapid growth of Omicron cases across the world meant it was appropriate at this point to remove the 11 countries from the red list from 4 a.m. on Wednesday, the 15th of December. Following clinical advice from senior clinical advisers, it was also considered appropriate that those in managed quarantine with a negative day two test with no subsequent positive test are eligible for release from 4 p.m. on Wednesday, the 15th of December. Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. Are members content for the motion on the agenda to be moved en bloc? If any member is not content, could you put an R in the chat function now? Thank you. Members are agreed to move the motion en bloc. I now invite the Deputy First Minister to move en bloc motions S6M-02339, S6M-02340, S6M-02341, S6M-02436, and S6M-02454.
It moved en bloc, Convener.
Thank you. And again, I will ask if any member would like to comment, could you put an R in the chat function now? I note that no member has indicated that they wish to speak, so I'll now put the questions on the motion. Question is that motions S6M-02339, S6M-02340, S6M-02341, S6M-02436, and S6M-02454 be agreed to. Do members agree? If anyone doesn't agree, please put R in the chat. Okay, thank you. The motions are agreed. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Deputy First Minister. I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be next Thursday on the 23rd of December, when we will be taking evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID recovery. And that concludes our public part of the meeting. I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave.